out of bad. He can be bring good out of any bad things. For all things work for the good for those who love the Lord. And so I studied, and I studied, and I prayed, and I prayed, and I was discipled under the chaplain and the bishop. And my life started coming together. And I started seeing the light. I started gaining the knowledge. And I started seeing the glory. And it reminds me of the stories in the Bible. It was like the Jews. They always sought for light. They was always after light. And the Romans, they were after glory. And the Greeks, they wanted the knowledge. Well known for their knowledge. And that's what I chased all my life. The light. The knowledge and the glory. But we find in 2 Corinthians 4:6, for it was God who said, let light shine out of the darkness, who has shown in our hearts to bring us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. There was the light, the knowledge, and the glory always there in the face of Jesus Christ. And I've seen it there so many times. But because I am who I am, a human being, not a bad person, prison is filled with good people, and good people make bad decisions. But we as human beings, with our own power, will always make bad decisions. That's why we must turn our lives over to Jesus Christ and invite Him into our lives. Let Him take control of our lives and live through us. And only then may we be pleasing and acceptable to the Lord. For it is not in our human nature to be good, for none is good except for the Lord God. So I just pray that this testimony will touch your heart. And that whatever you're seeking for, all good gifts comes from the Father of lights. Whatever you're seeking for, you will find it in the face of Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. And that's the end of my testimony.
Our loving Father and our God, Lord, we thank you right now for this time that you have allotted us.
Yes, Jesus.
For carrying us throughout this day without hurt, harm, or danger.
Thank you, Jesus.
Blessed Father, we know that it's by your mercy, your goodness, that we are still alive and well. We ask now, Blessed Father, that as we leave this place, that your Spirit would lead and guide us in the way that you would have us to go. Not our will, but your will be done in every aspect, every area of our lives. Blessed Father, we ask that you would go into the highways, into the hedges, and the ones that don't know you, Blessed Father, send your servants by that they might have an opportunity to accept your Son, Jesus. Heavenly Father, we love you, and we know that you love us because you've kept us thus far.
Thank you.
We're just asking right now that you continue to be God in our lives. These and other petitions we send up in your blessed Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. That's the whole thing. Okay.
Here.
Okay, would you open us up with prayer? Okay.
Our Father, I want to thank you again, Stephen, for bringing the brother and myself together again, Father God. Father God, I want to ask you to open up our minds and our hearts, Father God. I also want to thank you for our lives. I want to thank you for our family members, our loved ones. I want to also thank you, Father God, for being the Father that you are now and the Father that you have been in the past, Father God. Father God, I want to thank you for the pastor conference. I also want you to protect him as he leaves and go back home, Father God. I also want to thank you again for the brother and I just being a part of this tonight, Father God. And those that are not here, Father God, I want you to protect those also. Father God, I want to ask you in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, Father God. Thank you for letting this young man come out and take out his time just to share the word.
Amen. Okay, we'll start this off. It's not a counseling meeting, but remember, as we're talking here, someone's listening. And this may help and deter them where they're going, or they might be listening to it actually on prison on the internet. And you may actually be giving that spark that they need, because they need to hear it from you, because you've always heard the thing, an alcoholic can talk to an alcoholic. I've been homeless, so I can talk to people that are living in the street and say, listen, I've been where you've been. You know what I'm saying? But sometimes it takes to be incarcerated to talk to somebody else because they know what you know. So my first question, and it doesn't have to be super silent now, because this is discussion. And if you were to say, in your time that you were incarcerated, when do you feel that there was no hope? When was the time? Was it when you were arrested? Or when did you realize you needed God? Because that was the time that you were like at your worst. I need somebody, and there's nobody else left.
When I was away from my family, I didn't know nobody in jail, so I felt alone. Mm-hmm. And until I met somebody one night that took me to Bible study, from there, it had to be God, because 8 out of 10 words that came out of my mouth was cuss words. It ceased.
Wow, just so you're
23 days in jail.
And all of a sudden, just cursing and everything just stopped.
Smoking.
That's God. I've seen him do stuff like that. You're right. And what were you going to say, brother? I mean, speak a little loud, because I want to hear.
I've always had a friend and wife. And I always had a friend and mother alone. And me as an individual, I've always believed in God. But then I realized that God is for real. I've always went to church. I've always went to Bible study. But I've always did what I thought I wanted to do.
So what you're saying is, you knew God, but you didn't really know God.
I didn't really know God, because I've always, God is a protective God. Me as an individual, I sold drugs a long time. And sometimes I used to go on the lake and get my Bible, read the Bible, ask God to help me. I was tired. I would put that Bible back under my car. If somebody called me, I would go right back to what I was doing. My wife would tell me, "Sit down, you don't make my money. Get out of the game."
So what you're really saying is there's a lot of people that want to be Christians, but are only Christians in lip service.
Yes.
And we need to reach them to the heart, not just with some words.
Yeah.
Well, that's what you're saying.
Yeah, and so, you know, it's just like the habit that I've had all my life. You know, right now, I struggle with it. I'm going to be straight out with it. I've always gambled. I've always had my own gambling house. I've always had money. I made enough money just not to want no more money in life. But, you know, things, they always say good things always come to an end. Nothing lasts forever. See, as long as I sold drugs, I should have been stopped. But I knew it was going to come a time in my life when I was going to be stopped. I always think I was going to get killed. Or God was going to place me somewhere away from my family. You know what I'm saying? So, my wife was good to me. I was good to my kid. I was good to her. My time frame was away, just going here, going there, going this. So I said, "Well, Lord, I said, I'm tired. I need you to help. I need you, you know, to come into my life and just protect me, not let nothing happen to me." And so one night I was coming from a full out of bed, I just broke down in tears and said, "Lord, just take me and play me where you want me to be." You know, and I got this case. Mm-hmm. I never thought that. I've always thought I could get in trouble, but when I did, I underestimated pills. I never got busted with cocaine, heroin, none of those drugs. I got busted with OxyContin because I underestimated the pill. So, you know, you can't put trust in no man, because I had a friend I thought was alright, and when he got busted, he busted against some more people. But anyway, like I'm saying, you know, I knew God had protected me, because I ran up on the track and trailer truck and I was doing 110 miles an hour. It was full and I almost got thrown out the car. I was working with the city. We ran and flipped over the canal. I could see myself underwater, swimming, trying to get out the water. When the truck kept rolling, when it rolled, a light was shining right down on it, just like a fresh light. So I got out the truck, people ran out and helped us get out. Then a guy robbed me, put the gun to my head right in front of my house, me and another guy. He could have killed me, he did. So I asked God, I said, "I know you don't need nothing from me. Why you let me live? Why you didn't let me die in these incidents?" So all the time, you know, so all this happened. So this time around here, when I went to court, my lawyer told me that the case gonna be thrown out. I paid him a lot of money, so when I went in front of the judge, he said, well, you're gonna get 8 years. My family said, 8 years? The law said, look, he said, the last thing my lawyer told me, he said, look, Marie, you can sue me because I didn't represent you. So when I came to prison, he went to the feds. But anyway, you're not gonna say, you know, I know God has been in my life and protected me all these times on the street, even up until now. So, you know, I know God wants me to change my way of living. And so, like I said, I struggle every day, you know, trying to give my whole heart to the Lord, you know, and stuff like that. And so, it's a test. Either way, you know, that's what I'm saying. You know, I hope that I can give my whole heart to the Lord and not try to straddle the fence and do what I think.
Now that you've been, you all been into prison and incarcerated and all that, what? How do you feel about how it's changed you about sharing the word of God? I mean, are you like more aggressive about it, or what's your feelings of that? Because you know how the Bible says we're supposed to go out and share the gospel. But what do you think? How strong are you guys about that now? I mean,
well, I realize. When I was in South Florida, reception center, South Union, when an inmate was walking in the rec yard, he told me, well, that's your purpose for being here, because you have such a strong testimony. God's answered a lot of your prayers, he's healed me twice, and you need to share that with other people.
For me, when I was around 15 to 16 years old, I OD'd, and I had an out-of-body experience, and you know, while I was in and out, I had you know, I was talking to someone, and I know it was God. And I wanted to die at the time. And I kept on saying, I want to die. And I was seeing, like, faces of my life. And then all of a sudden, my mind wanted to change, came out of the thoughts. And I said, I want to live, God, just let me do something for you, whatever you want, I'll do it. I said, I'll work with kids, I'll do this, you know, I'll help out kids so they don't act the way I was acting. And ever since then, that's been on my mind. When I was about 17 years old, or 18, I started working with disabled, mentally challenged kids. And I love the job. And then by the time I, 2006, when I went down for a couple charges, I got out and I found God a lot stronger in my life. And I started working with the Youth for Christ and the children at this church. And I love that. It touched my heart to be able to talk to them, explain my testimony and, you know, help them out and be like a big brother to them. And, you know, that's where I believe God wants me to be.
Now, let me ask you all this, though. If you were to talk to someone who's going into prison now, okay, what would you say that if you could speak to them right there, like right now, they're standing right here, they're going to go to prison for whatever reason, they're convicted, they're going, and you wanted to share something about Jesus Christ or God, what would you say to them?
I would tell them that you can be free on the inside. I said, there's people out there that are in prison spiritually and they don't even know it. I said, once you have God in your life, you can be free on the inside. I said, he's real because he's answered a lot of my prayers. And I can give you a lot of testimony how I'm not even supposed to be in the work release. My own classification officer told me I would never be work release center.
And what would you say to somebody if you could speak to them and you know that they're going to get into a situation in prison? They're going to get into a situation because, you know, in prison you got to make a choice. Not like the outside world where you can wait your time. You're going to have to make a choice of what you're going to do or where you're going to be. But let's say something bad is going to happen and they have to make a choice. How would you encourage them to use Christ to get involved with that decision making, what they're going to do? How would you do that?
I would tell them, because I come, like I said, my testimony, I came from a JIT camp, and